For this next section called related rates, let's start by just thinking about a scenario. Suppose we throw a rock into a pond and we watch the ripples increase from that point of entry. Now, as those ripples increase, let's just suppose for the sake of simplicity here that the ripples are perfectly circular. So the ripples increase from that point of entry and the radius increases and the area of the ripple increases, the circular ripple increases. And those two rates are connected. They're not the same. The rate at which the radius increases is obviously going to be in inches per second or feet per second, something of that nature. And the area would be in inches squared per second or feet squared per second. But they are connected. The way in which the radius is increasing is connected and related to the way in which the area of those ripples is increasing. So, how do we use calculus to come up with this relationship, to see how those rates of change are actually related? And so that's this whole section that we're going to explore here, where we're going to look at this idea of related rates. And related rates refers to this application. This is an application of derivatives, so we're going to use what we've learned about derivatives here to apply to this concept. And it's going to allow us to take quantities that are related by nature or the way the situation is set up or the problem that we're given. And we're going to take derivatives so that we can see how the rates of change in those quantities are also related. So if two quantities are related in some way through a formula, through the situation, through the scenario, the problem that we're looking at, then the rates of change in those as time is going on, if those quantities are changing, will also be related. Okay, so how are we going to do this? Well, here's some steps, and I'm going to come back. I want to walk through an example as we go through these steps, and then at each step, we'll go back to the example and kind of go back and forth. But if you want to pause the video here, take some notes, go ahead and do that. The idea with related rates is that we first have to come up with the relationship between the quantities we're looking at. So that's parts one and two that I have diagrammed out here. The first thing we're going to do, of course, read the problem and draw a diagram if possible. A lot of times we're going to have a visual so that we can see the connection. So it's going to help to draw a diagram if we can. And then, of course, assign some variables. So we're going to have to define the variables that we're looking at. And then the second piece, which kind of goes hand in hand here, is to figure out what is the relationship that we're looking at? What are the quantities? How are the quantities that we're discussing related? What is the relationship? What is the equation? What is the formula that can be applied to connect the variables? So that's what we're going to do first before we get into any calculus. So let's take a look at this exact scenario that we were looking at. So a stone is thrown into a pond. It creates circular ripples whose area is increasing at a rate of 5 meters. The area, actually, I notice I have my square on the wrong spot there. That should actually be 5 meters squared per second. And then the question is, how fast is the radius increasing? So let's break this apart and organize our information. I'm going to go ahead and organize it into sort of a graphic organizer here, a table. And that's how I will set these up. So let's see if we can get a diagram or a picture. And so, of course, we've got this stone going in, and then we have these ever-increasing ripples occurring in some pond. It was the picture that I had. So we've got these ever-increasing circular ripples where this will define as R, our radius, and then A. So R will be our radius. Let's go ahead and define. R is our radius, and A, of course, is the area of the ripple, the circular ripple. And those are the variables that I'm going to use. Then the second step, and so this is, I'm doing steps one and two, define your variables, and then also come up with the equation. What is the relationship? So the equation or the relationship. I'm going to go ahead and write those top and bottom here. So the equation or the relationship between the quantities. Okay. Now, this is a pretty simple version to start with, simple problem, because the actual relationship between area and radius in a circle is pretty simple. So it's a formula. Area is pi times the radius squared. So it's just the area of a circle. Now, sometimes we'll have to do more work on this column and this spot as we're coming up with the relationship, but for our purposes for this one, we'll start off pretty simple. So it's the area of a circle, and I'm just using the formula. Okay, so that's what we're going to do first, is we're going to figure out what information is given, how does it connect the unknown quantities into an actual equation or relationship, a mathematical, when I say relationship, I do mean a mathematical relationship between the two quantities, or more quantities, sometimes we have more than just two, okay? Okay, so let's come back over here. So that's our first two steps. So determine, read the problem, draw a diagram, assign variables, determine the relationship between the quantities or the variables. And the third step is list all the known quantities in terms of the variables, such as the rates, etc., that we're given. Okay, so there's one lesson, that's why I set it up this way, but I didn't even label the top. The last thing that we want to do is we want to write the known values, and I'm going to add in a little piece here, at the snapshot in time, I'm going to say snapshot. Because there is this little piece that is given. It says, how fast is the radius of the circle increasing when the diameter is 10 meters? Now, think for a second. We throw in a stone into a pond and it creates circular ripples. Well, the diameter of those circles is ever changing, okay? So the diameter is not a constant 10 meters, right? This is at a little, this is a snapshot in time. It's the snapshot in time that we want to focus on. It's where we want to know what those rates of change are right at that moment in time, but it is not always 10 meters. So that is just a snapshot in time. And so I'm going to be really clear about that because we can't actually plug that in. It's not like we can come over here and plug that right in here for the radius. The area and the radius are changing quantities. This is at that snapshot in time. So when I write down R equals, it's D, diameter equals 10 meters, we do need to be clear about when this happens. This is at a specific time. So at the snap, well, I wrote it up above, so I'm not going to write it here. This is at that snapshot in time. The diameter is 10 meters at that snapshot in time. This is not a constant 10 meters. I want to be clear about that, that this is actually changing, okay? Changing diameter. But at that snapshot in time, at that moment that we're looking at it, that's why I highlighted this, and I want to be really clear about that, because that can be a point of confusion here. But if you pull back for a little bit from and look at the big picture, right? If you pull back a little bit from the details of just listing out the known information, if you pull back, you would obviously know that 10 meters is not a constant diameter for these ripples. These ripples are changing. So this is the known values at this snapshot. So the diameter equals 10 meters, and that would, of course, because we're not talking about diameter in our formula, I guess we could write the area related to the diameter, but it makes more sense just to say at that snapshot, at that same snapshot in time, the radius would be 5 meters. But again, a changing radius, right? So it's a changing diameter and changing radius. So we want to be really clear about that. Now, we are told here, this piece, the part that I had that little typo on, this piece, it says that those circular ripples, area is increasing at a rate of 5 meters squared per second. Now that is actually a fixed value. So the rate of change in the area with respect to time, we are going to indicate as dA dt. That's the rate of change. I'm going to write it rate in words too. Rate of change in area with respect to time. And that rate of change is at 5 meters squared per second. That was given in the problem. And let me zoom out. I just realized that went off the screen. 5 meters squared per second. So the rate of change with the area with respect to time, it's changing at 5 meters squared per second. And it's positive. So of course, like, these ripples are gaining area at 5 meters squared per second. Okay. So that is the known values at that snapshot in time. Turns out that the rate of change of the area with respect to time is actually constant throughout, and that was stated here. The areas are increasing at a rate of 5 meters squared per second. Okay, so how do we connect this? Well, in under my known values right here, I know it's kind of like I wrote known, but I'm going to actually also put in an unknown value. I think it's worth also, after you've listed everything that you know, writing what you're actually looking for. So I think it's worth putting down, because then you have your eye focused on what it is you're looking for. This is what we are actually looking to find. So what we're looking to find is the dr dt, the rate of change in the radius. The question was, how fast is the radius? And I have it highlighted and underlined already. How fast is the radius of the circle increasing at that snapshot in time when the diameter was 10 meters? Okay, so organizing everything is actually probably sorting through and organizing all the information in a problem is the hard part. That's why I put it into a graphic organizer, a table here. Helps me to keep everything straight. And then we go back, and now we're actually going to apply the calculus. But applying the calculus is not too difficult. We're just going to put a concept that we've already used together. So let's take a look at this. What we're going to do now, because we want to connect, we have the connection between the radius and the area. What we want to do now is we want to connect the rates of change of the area and the radius, dA dt with dr dt. Well, how would we do that? How would we get rates of change from an equation or a relationship? Well, we would take a derivative, right? A rate of change is a derivative. So how are we going to do it? We're going to differentiate both sides of the equation with respect to time. So we're going to take that operator d dt of both sides, and we're going to think of each variable as a function of time. And in fact, they are functions of time. So as we apply the chain rule, we will end up with our rates of change. So it's very much like when we apply implicit differentiation and we're thinking of y as a function of time. We're going to do the same sort of thing here, but we're going to do it with actual areas and radius in this particular problem. So I'm going to do it right here, a equals pi r squared, and I'm going to take the derivative with respect to time of both sides of this equation. Now, remembering what we're thinking of right here is that a is not just a, that a is a function of time, and it is. The area changes with time, and r is a function of time. So that's what we're going to be thinking in our heads. I'm not going to write it right up there. I just wanted to write it so that you could see what we're thinking. So we're going to take the derivative. The derivative of a, of course, is 1, but then the derivative of a as a function of time is dA dt. And pi is just a constant. So we're going to get equals, the derivative of r squared is 2r. So we're going to, let's write it this way. So we're going to have pi times 2r times, of course, we have to also think of r as a function of time. So when we take the derivative of r, we're going to have to multiply by dr dt. Both of our variables are functions of time. So we have to multiply using chain rule. We have to multiply by dA dt and dr dt. So we get 2 pi r dr dt. Now, remember what I'm actually looking for is dr dt, so I'm going to continue. I have the relationship between the rates of change. So notice what we end up with. We end up with a relationship between the functions, and after differentiating using some calculus, we now have a relationship between the rates of change. So we have a relationship between the two quantities, and now we've differentiated and we have a relationship between the two rates of change. Since I'm solving for dr dt, and I circled that over there, I'm going to take this one step further so that dr dt, if I just solve for dr dt, is going to be dA dt, the rate of change of the area with respect to time, divided by 2 pi times the radius. So I'm actually going to write that out. Okay. I could now find out what that rate of change is with the radius is with respect to time for any radius at any moment of time, when the radius is 1, when the radius is 2, when the radius is 3 meters, when the radius is 4 meters, when the radius is what we're looking for, 5 meters, because this is how it is related to the rate of change of area with respect to time. So now at that snapshot, so coming back to that snapshot in time, so at a diameter, and remember the snapshot was 10 meters, at a diameter of 10 meters, the radius is 5 meters, and dr dt is going to be equal to 5 meters squared per second over 2 pi times 5 meters, plugging in the radius into our plugging the radius right into our formula that we've derived for the rate of change of the radius with respect to time. So of course the meters are going to cancel, the fives are going to cancel, and we end up with 1 over 2 pi meters per second. And that is our answer. That is how fast. I guess we could approximate that. I didn't actually do that ahead of time, so let me grab my calculator. If we wanted to know exactly what that is, 1 over 2 pi, just plugging it into the calculator, that is approximately 0.159 meters per second. Now, that is very specific. That is at when the radius is exactly at 5 meters. I want to just make a note. It wasn't part of the problem, but I want to make a little note here. What if we had asked the same question, but we wanted to know when the radius is, what is the rate of change? Just because I want to be clear that it's a different rate of change. What is the rate of change in the radius when the diameter is 2 meters? Okay. So remember, when the diameter is 2 meters, the radius would be 1 meter, right? So when the diameter is 2 meters, the radius would be 1 meter, and dr/dt would be 5 meters squared per second, because dA/dt is staying constant, the rate of change of the area with respect to time, and it would be over 2 pi times 1 meter. Let's put the units in, 1 meter. And what we end up with is 5 over 2 pi meters per second. And 5 over 2 pi meters per second is definitely a different rate. It's changing at a different rate. It is changing at approximately, the radiuses are increasing at approximately 0.796 meters per second. And that is definitely a faster rate of change in the radius at when the radius is smaller. So the radius is growing faster when it's smaller than it is when it gets bigger. So just to be really clear, that when we talk about these rates of change, we're looking at them at a specific moment in time. Okay? And so that idea of a snapshot is important, that we think about not just the relationship of the rates of change, but also the moment in time that we want some sort of data. So when we're plugging in numbers, we're taking a moment in time, because if things are changing, if quantities are changing with respect to time, then when we look at it at a specific moment in time, it's like a little snapshot, like we're freezing time for a moment to answer the question. And if we wanted to look at it at a different moment, then we would probably be plugging in different values like we did here. Okay. All right, so let's just go back one last time to end out this intro video to related rates, and just put out the steps again. So just remember, we're going to have another, at least one more video with several more examples on related rates, but we've got the basics down now. So when we want to solve a related rates problem, what we're going to do is we're going to read the problem, draw a diagram if we can, assign variables, and come up with the relationship, come up with the mathematical relationship between the variable or the variables that we're looking at. Okay. The quantities discussed. Then we're going to list all the known quantities. This is at that snapshot in time. So when we list out the known quantities, remember that snapshot in time. So remember that we look at it as a snapshot in time. Once we've got that all organized, then we can differentiate both sides, come up with the relationship for the rates of change, remembering that as we differentiate with respect to time, we'll think of each of the variables as functions of time, and then we can solve for the unknown quantities by substituting back in the known quantities. Yeah. Okay, so I'm gonna end the video here, and then we'll come back and do several more examples.